Grid. Grid is the foundation of web layouts, shaping everything from complex landing pages and dashboards to simple icons. So we are so excited to introduce a brand new option this year at Config, Grid. Now you can design and maintain galleries, bento boxes, and more without having to do workarounds, deep nesting, or rigid layout constraints. Unlike regular auto layout, Grid lets you work in two dimensions, both columns and rows. This means you can structure more flexible, responsive designs without having to nest multiple layers. With Span, you can drag content across multiple cells, perfect for, let's say, asymmetrical style layouts, those bento style layouts. So you can expand charts to emphasize key metrics or make call to actions stand out by spanning them across your layout. You can also fine-tune how items sit inside each cell, positioning things to the left, right, or center, giving you even more control. And finally, if you want exact control, you can drag to resize individual tracks to a fixed width or height for your designs. I am gonna begin by talking about the very first thing that you're gonna do when you're using Grid. For those of you that haven't yet used it, Grid is a new auto layout option in Figma. It's something that you can add to a frame. You'll notice that when I select this frame here, I come over to the layout panel. Auto layout's a little bit different. We have freeform objects, that's when you have things inside of a frame. We have vertical auto layout stacks, horizontal auto layout stacks. The wrap auto layout stack will show up as an option when you enable that. We also have the new grid. When I select that, you'll notice that this frame now has a number of different grids. It's by default a 2x2 grid. Now, when I drag objects into that grid, we're gonna see how they get placed in, and we can then rearrange them as necessary. So one quick thing is that Grid also works with Shift A. So if there's a lot of you auto layout aficionados out there, if you have a structure that is, you know, already looking like it appears to be in a grid, when I press Shift A, you see that it's going to pick the best auto layout option available for that. So when I press Shift A, we see that those squares are now in a gridded position. So let's get a little bit deeper. Grid is two-dimensional. We're gonna work with columns, rows, padding, and gap. Now, if you are also coming from, let's say, a print background, gap is going to be your gutters, and your padding is going to be like your margins when you're working with Grid. So when I select this here, I'm gonna come over, you'll see that Grid is already enabled. When I click on this, I can actually change the amount of rows and columns available within this layout. So let's extend that out by a value of 4. And 4. Now over here, I have a shape. This shape has a stroke enabled on it. So if you want to visualize how Grid is working, I can select that object, press Command D. I'm duplicating this object inside of that grid. When you no longer have available area and I press Command D, it will attempt to create another row to begin to compensate for that. So let's take a look at that same concept again. Now thinking about the padding and the gaps associated with it. This is just like an auto layout wherein you have padding on the outside and a gap on the inside. Here, when I click on the canvas, you'll see I can actually adjust the padding manually. Those values, when you select that frame, you come over here on the right, you can see how they show up. So you have the gap value. I can change that value by typing in 32, press tab, 32, and you'll see that it changes there. The gap value doesn't get edited on the canvas. There's UX kind of reasons for this, but the padding will be able to be adjusted here. So I can manually adjust that padding. Or pro tip, if you want to adjust all of your padding at the same time, if I command click on the padding field here on the right, I can type in any value that I want and it will edit all four sides, just like that. So if I were to take a look at this frame, this grid frame, you can see I have a number of objects already within it. When I adjust this gap value, you see the gap applied there. I adjust that vertical gap, and then I begin to adjust that padding. You can see that the objects that are occupying the cells inside of that grid frame, right? They're currently set to fill in both directions. So the resizing of those objects is currently set to fill and fill as they're placed inside of those cells. So when I adjust the row gap or the vertical gap or the padding, they're then going to be more inset. That allows me to then edit those values. So you can see here, I'm adjusting those values. I can move that left and right. And we're going to move on to actually building out a little bit more of a design example. So here I'm going to build out a little layout of animal facts. Who doesn't love animal facts? I'm going to click on this grid. You can see that I currently have a 6x4 grid. So we have 6 columns across, 4 rows down, and I have some images. I'm going to take this text field first, and I'm going to drop it right into that first field there. And I can actually span this all the way across. So the cells across that top row are spanned all the way across. Now I can actually select and drag all 3 of these images in there. You'll see that as I drag them in, they kind of get highlighted and now they're placed inside. So it's gonna take the available space that I need for those. Now, if I want to make any adjustments, you know, I can kind of move that, I could snap it right. But for our animal facts, we are going to add in some additional text. So I dragged in this text field here. I'm going to select these 2, and you're going to see that it's going to look for the available space and it's going to snap them in. If you are concerned at all, or you just want to see how is it filling up that space, just look down here. When I select that text field, I can see 2 columns by 1 row, and I can see that they're currently set to fill. This text field that I have right here, it's currently aligned to the bottom. If I wish, I can align it to the top. I can make those adjustments. Now, if I want to adjust the track sizing, this is going to be something we're going to talk a little bit about. Right now, each one of these rows have an even value. They're all set to auto. But let's say for this title, I want to change that value. When I come over here and I hover over, you're going to see these dots show up. When I click into it, I can then type in a manual value. So I can say 200. Or what I can do, you'll see this bar that kind of highlights. That's going to allow me to adjust that track. So this is track sizing. So I'm applying a fixed value size to that entire row. And you can see that the content in the remaining rows, they are going to be set to auto. Fun fact, when you're working with the track sizing, you can press the tab key and see all of the values as they're set. That fill resizing means that they are going to be responsive to that container. So once again, that's going to be our animal fact. So let's say here I made a little calendar grid. You can see when I resize my calendar, it just has a bunch of numbers inside their aligned sensor. I could take this calendar, drop it over here. Let's say I don't want it to occupy that full space of a calendar. I can drag it just to the right and snap it right there. If I wanted to add additional elements, maybe some more photos of pugs into my calendar as well. So nesting grids inside of grids is going to be really helpful as you're working. Now, as we start to get into more advanced gridding, you're going to want to start to use other frames as well as component instances. I have a deeper example that we're going to get into, but I'm going to impart on you to really begin to think about how your components resize, as well as the constraints of the objects within the components. So you see here, I have a bunch of instances. These are actual icons created by Tim Vanham that currently exists in the Figma editor. These are for adjusting the bordering of objects. If I was to select all of these, here, I just need to reset my example here. I realize I didn't reset it. So if I select all of these icons and I want to, like, let's say display them as a sticker sheet in my design system, when I drag them in there, look what happened. that's not what I wanted to happen. Let's hit undo. So I'll show you what's happening, right? These icons all have constraints inside of their instances that are telling them to scale. So when I drag them in, they're scaling to those edges. And that's not actually what I want. That's not the behavior that I want. That's not the resizing behavior that I want. Instead, I'm going to select all of these, right? And look down here, I got my little shortcuts here. We're going to select the children. We're going to press enter. That's actually going to select the objects that are inside of those instances. So the current strength constraints on these icons are set to scale. We don't want them set to scale. We want them to center. So I'm going to come over here. Let's center that and center that. And because we selected them all, we pressed enter, we selected those children, and now we've reset those constraints. When we drag them in, they're going to be nice and lovely. They're not going to scale to fit those spaces, right? The instance itself is just kind of expanding. So I'm just using this as an example to show you how objects are going to relate when they're dropped into those frames. So let me hit undo.
This is going to be the last screen that you see on your iPhone when you swipe all the way over when you see the application library here. I actually have a grid inside of a grid inside of a grid, but I'm using this example to show you how absolute positioning works with grid. So it's also known as ignore auto layout. I'm going to select this instance. I'm going to hold down the control key. If you're on Windows, it's the S key. I'm going to drag this inside of this component. And you can see it populating over here, so we know that it's inside. Now I'm going to move it to the top right. I'm also going to set its constraint to the right because I want the numbers, if I were to update it, to move from the right to the left. So I've added this in. You can see it's populating here. So let's just give this a quick look and see what it looks like as a prototype. There we go. I'm also using a progressive blur on the top. So I have a progressive blur layer. That's one of those new Figma Draw features that I absolutely love. And you can see here a nice example where we have grid within grid within yet again another grid. So find those examples. Also let us know what's an example that you found a great opportunity for grid.